Church, how is everybody doing this morning? Well, it is a gorgeous day, and I am excited to be in this place and to be ready to worship with you. As you can tell, Kyle and Aaron are not here this morning. They are out of town, but they'll be back with us again soon. So prayers for them as they're traveling to visit family, and for also for a safe return so that they are back with us next week. Friends, as we begin our service this morning, I'm going to begin with some centering words. I'm going to ask you to just kind of quiet your hearts and minds and to reflect on these words. This is a place to pause from the hustle and bustle of our days. This is a time to listen to the spoken word, enjoy the notes of a song, find joy in the face of our neighbor, and dwell in the Spirit of God. At this time, I would invite you to stand if you can comfortably do so and join in our opening songs. The first one is Shine, Jesus, Shine, and the words will be on the screen. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with. Thank you.
let's join together. Dear gracious and loving God, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity to be in this place to worship you. Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit
move and stir our hearts and minds to hear your truth, whether it is through word or through song, through the scriptures, or through our prayers. Lord, just help us to hear your truth and be equipped and empowered to go out and to do ministry in the world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, so some quick announcements for you. Again, welcome to all of you. Welcome if you are joining us online as well. We are glad that you are here to worship with us. As always, just draw your attention to the online resources that we have, and we really encourage you to engage with those resources. It's a great way to be part of our community and also stay up to date with what our church community is doing. One of the ministry events that I want to highlight in this coming week is Bar Hopping with the Pastor, and that's going to be this Friday, May 20th. It'll be at the Bloomer Brewery here in town, and I've got a special guest. I think Pastor Paul from the Holcomb Jim Falls and Anson Church is going to come and be with us, so you get two for the price of one. So if you want to come and hang out with us for a little bit, and just a reminder, you don't need to drink or anything like that. It's just a time that we get together and we can join in some discussion and dialogue and just be with each other in a different place, in a different location. So all that are of age are welcome to come and to be a part of that. All right, young disciples, you guys want to come up here for a minute and have a seat in the front row? So do you guys know what an idol is? An idol. No idea, right? Okay. Well, in the old days, an idol was a statue or a figurine or maybe even something else, some sort of an image that people would worship. They would say prayers to it, they would worship it, and they would ask the idols to give them certain things, okay? So can we pretend this is an idol, right? It's got a little man-made figure there, and we could pretend to give it prayers and to worship it. But if we give it prayers and worship it, is it really going to do anything for us? No, right? So one of the things we're going to talk about today and one of the things we're going to hear in our message is that God says, look, folks, you guys can't worship idols, all right? It's not good for you guys, okay? And so, do you think we still have idols today?
Yeah.
Okay, well, how do you think we still have idols today?
I saw one.
You saw one?
Yeah.
Okay. So, do the idols today maybe look the same as they did in the old days, where they were actual images of a person or some other thing? No. Sometimes they're... Well, let me put it this way. An idol is anything we put in front of God. Right? And that can be a real tricky thing. Hey, Cash, Clay, pay attention. All right. So an idol can be anything we put in the way of God. And so sometimes it could be a toy, right? Like maybe we pray or we don't pray to the toy, but we spend so much time worrying about that toy that we forget to maybe pray to God. Or maybe we're going to go and do some stuff. Maybe we're going to go on a big family vacation and take a trip. And that's a really good thing. But maybe on that trip, we don't spend any time with God. So did we make that trip an idol? We did, right? What about other things in our lives? Can we make sports an idol?
Yeah.
Yeah? For us adults, can we make our jobs an idol?
Yes.
Right? To get really down to the nitty-gritty, can we make our families an idol? Yeah, we can. We can, right? I mean, it gets hard because sometimes we'll put our families, even our love, the people we love the most, in front of God. But God gives us an order and he says, no, you know what? I always need to be first. And then your family, and then your friends, and then these other things down below. Okay? So one of the things that we can do to make sure that we're not making idols out of anything is to make sure each and every day we're spending time with God and we're thinking about our lives and saying, okay, is there anything in my life that I put before God? Okay, so can you guys do that kind of hard work, making sure you're spending time with God every day and not saying prayers to your toys or your statues or any goofy thing like that? All right? It is weird, right? We don't necessarily understand the way they used to do stuff, but we have our own ways of doing it that just looks a little different. So let me pray for you guys, and then you guys can have a seat. So, dear Lord, we just thank you for our young disciples. We thank you for the work that you are doing in their lives. Lord, we just ask that they would continue to grow and mature in your love and in your grace. Help this church to continue to come around and support them as they grow. And Lord, help them to make sure that nothing comes between you and them, and that they just keep an eye out for anything that they might put in their place. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, you guys, go have a seat. All right. Well, friends, at this time, we are going to bring forth our offering. I'm going to invite you to stand, if you can comfortably do so, as we sing our doxology this morning. God, we lift these offerings before you, and I thank you for the generous hearts of each and every one of the givers. Lord, we pray that you would just multiply these gifts for use in your kingdom, that we may be of service and of ministry to those people, whether they're here in our church, in our community, or even at large in the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated this morning. All right, folks. Well, we are on week 4 of our sermon series going through the 7 churches in Revelation. And I want to go through and just do a really brief recap. And so obviously the purpose of this series is for us to examine the letters that Jesus gives to each and every one of the churches, and to see if there are things in there that we might learn both for ourselves and as a church about some of the warnings that he gives, but also to see if we might not fit into some of the commendations that he gives churches as well. So in week 1, we looked at the church of Ephesus, and we learned that was a church that had lost its first love. And Jesus said, look, church, you're doing a lot of good things. You're a really hard-working church, but I need you to get back and to love God and to love each other the way that you used to do. In week 2, we looked at the church of Smyrna, and we called that the suffering church, because they were sort of afflicted and persecuted, and God, Jesus was speaking to them, giving them hope and encouragement, saying, look, just continue to persevere and get through, and I know exactly what you're going through, but just continue to fight the good fight. Last week, we looked at the church of Pergamum, and we looked at a church that was just beginning to compromise with truth and with some of its deep beliefs, and Jesus kind of calls them on that and says, look, guys, you gotta pay attention, because what you're doing is not right, okay? Now, I do want to just say this, that the church of Pergamum, the church of Thyatira, and the church of Sardis, which we'll look at next week, sort of form this progression as you go through. And so, again, Pergamum was a church that was just beginning to compromise with truth and beliefs. Today, we're going to look at the church of Thyatira, which we might call the sick church, that actually has begun to tolerate some things in the church that are not appropriate. And then next week, we'll look at the church of Sardis, which we might call the dead church, where they have major things wrong and they're basically on life support. So keep that in the back of your mind as we go forward. Now, I do have to create some context here, and I don't normally do this within a sermon, but friends, this is another, I think, difficult message that we're forced to confront this morning. And so, friends, I'm going to tell you, even based on the last service that I just did, that this might hit some of you in a very difficult way. But my prayer for you is this morning is that you will keep an open heart and an open mind. And if you feel like a wall is coming up by some of the things that I'm saying, I'm going to ask you to try to push that down and really engage with the scriptures this morning to see what God is speaking to you. Okay? So, again, just a brief... Oops, I better turn that on, I suppose. So there is our map, and you can see the town of Thyatira. It's about 45 miles southeast of Pergamum, so it would be our second top dot. So if you can't read it, it's the second church to the top up there. The city was known for its industry. It had a lot of commerce guilds within it. But other than that, it's sort of an insignificant town, right? There's not a lot of information on it. It's not a prominent town like Ephesus or Pergamum, which were capitals for the Roman Empire. But interestingly enough, despite that, Jesus offers perhaps one of the longest letters in Revelation to this church. And I think that we begin to understand why as we look at it a little deeper. So let's go to the scriptures and chapter 2, and if you're following along, it's verses 8. We'll start with verse 18. And so here John writes what the glorified Christ is telling him. And he says, "To the angel of the church at Thyatira write, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like a blazing fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did at first." Okay, so again, last week I encourage you to think about the attributes that are associated with each church. And last week we looked at Jesus as this person who has this sharp double-edged sword coming out of his mouth, right? This sword of truth. Well, I want us to consider, and we'll get back to this in a little bit, but consider that blazing fire and those burning feet and what they might symbolize. And I'm going to say that, think of it again, in a town full of industry and commerce, that this might be something like a crafter shop, right? Like a refining furnace, if you will. These blazing eyes and these brownish burns feet, something that is meant to purify, cleanse, and mold into something else. All right? Now, as we get into verse 19, Jesus really commends this church. He says, "I know your deeds, your love, your faith, and your service, and what you're doing now is even greater than what you did at the beginning." And friends, I think that that's such a prominent lesson for us as a church and even as individuals that, you know, despite what happens in our lives, you know, and we know that this life that we live has these big ups and downs sometimes, and that we run into challenges and conflicts. And Jesus says, look, even in that, you've persevered through it, and you're doing better things now than you were at the beginning. Okay? And so, friends, I think that's vitally important for us to remember that we're called to end the race well. No matter what gets thrown at us, no matter how challenging things get, will we be people, will we be a church that continually strives to do better at the end than we did at the beginning? Or will we be a church that wants to live back in the glory days saying, you know what, I remember back when and this, the church was on fire, the church was doing this, the church was doing that. But again, friends, Jesus is always working both in our lives and in the church. And he's saying, look, just because things were good back then doesn't mean they can't be good here. Yes, maybe they'll look different, but you need to keep moving. You need to keep striving towards the end. You need to finish the race well. Now, friends, as I said, we might call or title the church of Thyatira the sick church. And the reason we call it that is because they're openly tolerating sin within their presence. Okay? And so Jesus says this. He says, "Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate a woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols." Okay? So again, there's this designation of someone within the church who has some level of authority. This person, Jezebel, and again, we don't know if that's her actual name. It could be. However, I think it's more likely a reference to the Canaanite queen in 1 and 2 Kings. We remember Ahab and Jezebel, and we remember that Jezebel was really an antagonist within 1 and 2 Kings, right? She was the one that wanted to kill Elijah. She constantly tried to seduce the Israelite people into the worship of Baal. And so I think that is the reference here and why John, or Jesus in this case, calls her that name and says, look, you have this person in here who's constantly trying to seduce my people into the worship of things that they shouldn't be worshiping. Okay? And now, again, friends, when we hear words like sexual immorality, there is some nuance in those words. It may be very possible that literally this was what's happening, because in the ancient world they had fertility cults that had sexual practices associated with that. And so it, in the literal sense, maybe she is trying to blend some of these pagan fertility rituals in with Christianity. But more likely, again, that term can be used widely and broadly to talk about idol worship. Okay, the fact that this person is seducing or encouraging people within the church to worship other gods. Okay, and again, as we go through Scripture, we see a lot of reference towards that type of activity, right? And we hear this very sometimes difficult sexualized language of someone who basically as a people who have an affair against God, right? That again, in the image of Christ coming down as the groom looking for his bridegroom in the marriage that will happen, and how that oftentimes the people are unfaithful. So there's a lot of that imagery that goes with that, all right? Now again, friends, this is, I think, a pretty dire warning, and we can go back to the Gospel of Mark. And if we look at verse 9, what did Jesus say about or to anyone who tried to seduce or hurt people that believed in him? Well, he says, but whoever causes one of these little ones who believes in me to stumble, it would be better for him to have a millstone hung around his neck and be thrown into the sea. Okay, and so he's saying, look, you've got someone in a position of authority who's leading people into this idolatry, who's leading people away from what they're actually supposed to be doing. And friends, there's consequences for that. And again, if you take Jesus literally in the Gospel of Mark, you'd be better off to be dead than you would be to try to pull people away. And so friends, I think that serves as a big warning, especially to people who are in positions of authority, okay? Now, I want us to go back and I want us to look at the words I highlighted in bold. And again, to go back and to say that the Church of Pergamum was beginning to compromise on their beliefs and truth. Like, they were starting to dabble and play with this, right? Well, again, friends, the church at Thyatira is openly tolerating something that's not appropriate. All right, to give you a very weird example, well, it's not so weird in our day and age anymore, but it would be like the pastor of a church having an affair with the secretary, right? And then the church just being okay with it and just going, oh, well, it's their life to live and they look so happy and they create a whole bunch of justifications, right? Just most of us hearing that realize and say, you know what, that's just not the way things are supposed to be, right? That's not how the church is to be ordered. That's not how the pastor is to conduct him or herself within the church, okay? And so there's this tolerance by the people of the church for what this person is doing. And so friends, I want us to talk today about what I think has really become another idol in our life, and that is the idol of tolerance, okay? And to begin with, I want us to examine sort of a shifting definition of this word, because what it originally used to mean and what it represents now are two totally different things. Okay, and so in the classical liberal sense, the word or the definition for tolerance used to be that, you know what, I'm not a perfect person, but I can agree that you might have different thoughts or beliefs than me, and I can tolerate those beliefs. And we can have a discussion about those beliefs, even though they're different. Okay, and that's sort of the classical definition of it. And I think if we were to operate out of that, many of the problems we see in our day and age would disappear, right? Because we could actually have open conversations with each other. And in that sense, I would say tolerance actually promotes freedom. It actually encourages diversity within a group of people. And so tolerance in that aspect is a good thing. However, tolerance, or at least the definition of it, has become a politicized word. It's become a politically correct and charged word within our culture today. And it now no longer means just simply that you and I have different beliefs, but it now assumes that because you have different beliefs, I have to affirm those beliefs. And if I don't affirm and agree with those beliefs, then I'm intolerant. All right? And friends, that is an excess of power, and it's gone to a place that is not healthy. Now, in order to understand why it's gone there, again, we have to go back to this postmodern philosophy, this postmodern world that we live in, right? And for the people who subscribe to this postmodern philosophy, there is no absolute truth. Right? They believe all paths or all narratives that people want to create represent truth for themselves. All right? Now, as Christians, we find ourselves in conflict with that because Christianity and the gospel make very specific truth claims. Right? We say things like, there is only one God. You know, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man shall come to the Father except by me. That, my friends, is an exclusive truth statement, and we have to wrestle with that, right? But when we say things like that into this culture of tolerance, believing that we have to affirm it, when we say, guess what, you know, this is the truth, people get offended because they think, well, who are you not to affirm what I believe or what I'm doing, all right? Now, friends, interestingly enough, and I think many of you will agree with this, that it's gotten to such a point that the people who tolerance is the great ideal are often the most intolerant people that there are. Okay? Because look at many of the actions that happen with, again, the small minorities on the fringes of each side of the political spectrum. Anytime they don't get their own way, they immediately come after the larger majority for being intolerant of their beliefs. All right? And they're willing to go to great lengths, even to the lengths of violence, to say that, to prove how intolerant other people are. Think of the church, again, with some of the truth claims that are being made, right? If you don't affirm this belief or this lifestyle or this choice, guess what? You're a racist, you're a bigot, you have some phobia, any number of them down the line, right? And we actually have people, a lot of young people, in fact, that are scared to death to even confront the church right now because they're scared that they might be labeled one of those things. And so, friends, when tolerance, and especially this new definition, is taken to excess, it just basically becomes a bully. And it's meant to shut people down and say, look, you don't agree with me, I'm going to bully you in and scare you till you're quiet. And if you don't be quiet, guess what? We're going to come to conflict, and it's actually going to be physical. And so, friends, it's very dangerous when tolerance is taken to this degree. Let me give you another example within the church. You know, there used to be a time within the church when we preached and we talked and we taught and we said, look, we're reading the scriptures or we're confronting this thing, and is this true? And now many of us walk around on eggshells saying, you know what, did I actually offend anybody? Right? That's more what we're worried about rather than discovering whether what we're teaching and preaching and reaching out to is true. Friends, think of, again, another example of what it looks like or can look like. Again, we'll use it as a theoretical example, but of a parent who never lets their child go out, that a parent who just constantly tolerates a child doing whatever they want whenever they want, right? They become spoiled. They become entitled. They don't think they have to do anything. There's an abdication of responsibility, right? And if that parent keeps coming back and saying, oh, I'm, you know, you made that, that's all right. You made that mistake. Oh, you did this. Oh, you failed at this. Oh, you blah, blah, blah. You make all of these excuses for them. Pretty soon you find out that you have a 40-year-old child living in your basement that doesn't want to leave. And friends, it's becoming an epidemic in our society, right? We have large numbers of kids who are failing to launch partly because of some of this stuff. And again, friends, that was a very broad generalization. You can take me to task on that if you want to. But there's a problem there, right? And as we look at nature and we look at the scientific world, life doesn't work that way very often, right? Think about birds. There comes a time when babies get big enough that the mama bird says, you know what? You got to fly. Get the heck out of here. And if you don't, it's a long way down. All right? And so, again, friends, we have to be careful that we don't take things like tolerance to an excess, because it becomes very harmful for people, perhaps even the people we love. Now, I do want to caveat it with this, because tolerance is often given the nature of compassion, right? We like to think we're tolerant people, that we're compassionate people, that we're going to give people the benefit of the doubt, right? And that we should do. Again, if you go back to the classical definition that says, you know what, I can respect that you don't believe the way that I believe, but that doesn't mean I have to believe that what you're doing is good and correct, right? And so we can offer that compassion to people to say, you know what, yeah, we understand. We're all on a journey. We all have problems. We all have things we need to work out, and we can agree to disagree. But friends, again, there needs to be a counterbalance, okay? And that counterbalance is justice, okay? Because justice sets up a hierarchy and says, look, God put in place an order here. There's order, and there are rules that need to be followed in order for people to thrive. Because again, when tolerance or compassion is taken to an excess, it just basically says, we don't care enough about you. We don't really love you. We're just not going to care what you do. Okay, that's not really love. That's not really compassion. All right? Now again, can justice be taken to an extreme? Yes, absolutely it can. Then becomes oppressive and tyrannical, and it says, look, if you don't measure up to the grade or you fail, we're going to beat you down so hard that you can't get back up. Well, again, you get beat down so many times and most people don't want to get up anymore. So when justice is taken to an extreme, you have a problem as well. And so friends, there needs to be this balance between compassion and justice, okay? And that's why when we look at the person of Jesus Christ, we see Jesus as the Lamb, but we also see Jesus as the Lion of Judah. It's the reason we see Jesus, the suffering servant, nailed to the cross, and as we look, especially in the book of Revelation, to the glorified Christ, the King of all creation. Right, there's a reason that Scripture presents him in both that ways, because he embodies both that grace and compassion that says, look, I love you, and yes, you made some mistakes, but I'm going to give you another chance, and I need you to get up and keep moving forward. But he's also a God that says, look, I have rules, and there's an order to this creation that I've made, and you need to follow those so that you can thrive and live the kind of life that I desire you to have. And so he begins to take this church to task. Okay, and he says, you know what? I've given this woman time to repent, but she is unwilling to do so. And so again, it's not just like Jesus is coming down full force saying, look, this woman screwed up one time. She's out of here, right? And again, you could put a man in this place too. I don't think gender matters here. There's a leader in place and they made a mistake and they're out of there. No, again, that's the compassionate Jesus saying, look, I've given this person time to come in and to correct the things. I've tried to convict the heart and say, look, what you're doing is not right, but they're unwilling. And because they're unwilling to do that, there's going to be a judgment. There's going to be suffering. And I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely unless they repent of their ways. All right? Now, again, many of us are not real comfortable with this side of Jesus, right? We love that Jesus loves us and forgives us. We're not real excited that he holds us accountable and he's really, really ready to take us to task and give us a judgment when we refuse to move back towards him. All right? And so, friends, again, one of the key lessons here is that, again, there's a balance and there's an order to things. And he's saying, church, look, you have this ugly stain. You have this tumor in you right now that needs to be removed because it's going to infect the entire church. And if you don't remove it, eventually you're going to die because it's just going to spread. So you need to remove this tumor from the church. And if you don't do it, then I'm going to come in and I'm going to do it. And so, friends, go back to the imagery of Jesus again with these fiery eyes and the burnished bronze feet, right? These eyes pierce through. They pierce through the veil and the facades that we put in place to try to hide the dark things that we have going on. And Jesus says, guess what, folks? I already know what's going on in your heart and mind. And guess what, church? You can try to hide this from the public, but I see exactly what's going on in your church, and it needs to be fixed, or there's going to be consequences. You're going to hurt people. And so God, and so Jesus is a God who searches in our hearts and our minds and constantly calls him back to us, saying, look, I love you so much that I'm not willing to let you live this way, because this way is hurting you, it's killing you, and you need to come back, and you need to walk the straight and the narrow path. And yes, we'll continue to make mistakes. We're a fallen people. We all sin, and we all need God's grace and love. But there's also a response that comes from that grace and that love. So friends, then Jesus moves on and he encourages, I think, the rest of the body of the church. And he says, you know, to the rest of you in Thyatira who do not hold to her teaching, I will not impose any other burden on you except hold on to what you have until I come. And again, friends, it's this call back to truth. It's a call back to faith and say, look, you know you're grounded in the truth. You're grounded in my love, and you need to hold on and you need to cling to that no matter how bad it gets, right? Often, friends, I like to liken it to a rope, right? Have you ever seen a rope unravel and it gets down sometimes to the very last thread? Well, sometimes that's how some of us feel, right? That we're hanging on by the last thread, that we don't know how much more we can take until we're ready to break. And yet Jesus says, look, no matter how hard it gets, despite all of the crap you got going on in your lives and in the church, cling to what you know. Grab onto that rope with both hands and don't let go, because I have you. And I'm going to come back and I'm going to make all things right. Make all things new. So there's a call to perseverance even in the midst of struggle and conflict. Jesus also, as he does with each and every church, offers a reward. And he says, so church, if you're able to be victorious, I'm going to give you authority over all the nations. Right? You who have struggled, who have done your best, I'm going to give you authority over them because you know how to rule. I'm going to give you a place of authority and power within my kingdom. And you're going to be able to go through and to have power over the nations. And some of them you may dash into pieces like pottery. You may take the scepter and just shatter them because they're not in alignment with the kingdom of God. And then, friends, he also says, I will give that person the morning star. And, friends, if you go into Revelation 22, I believe it is, who is the morning star? None other than Jesus himself, right? And so Jesus says, look, if you're able to persevere through this, if you're able to cling on and to hold to what you know and try to be as healthy as you can and continue to move forward, you get me. And I'm going to be able to fill you and give you life in a way that you never, ever experienced before. So the gift is me, and I give you all of myself. And so whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So friends, again, I have some potentially difficult questions for us to consider as individuals and a church. The first one is, have we embraced tolerance over truth, either as individuals or as a church? Are we a sick people or a sick church? Are there things within our own lives? Again, think of that tumor analogy, right? Are there things within our own lives that we need to get rid of? Are there things within our church Are there tumors within our church that we need to get rid of? And then, friends, one of the ways we do that is, again, by taking responsibility to do the best that we can to make sure that our own house is in order and to make sure that the church is in order. Okay? And so, friends, do we need to set things right? And if so, let's begin to do that. At this time, let us move into a time of prayer. And if you have anything that you would like to share, either a joy or a prayer request, I invite you to lift those up before the congregation now. Jan. So that was a prayer request for Mary and Gordy. Difficult road before them, and so just peace and comfort for them as they move through perhaps end stages. Phyllis. Okay, so prayers for that family and for that little baby who will be born, and we pray for successful surgery and recovery as well, but also pray that that little baby will be a blessing to the family. Yeah. Okay, so continued prayers for Jean following heart surgery. So prayers of recovery. Anything? What's that? I don't. So yes, continued prayers for May. She was in the hospital again this week. She was having some breathing problems, and she was sounded hopeful, but she always sounds hopeful. So we'll be checking in on her. But just continued prayers for her as well. Obviously, friends, I would like continued prayer for the conflict in Ukraine and Russia and just the global impact that that is having on some very poor countries and the ability to even get necessary food items and things like that. And then I think many of us have heard about the tragedy in Buffalo the last couple of days, that shooting that took place. And so, friends, again, just prayers for all of the victims, families, and that community as they look to move forward and to heal from that devastating event. So, friends, at this time, I'm going to invite us to take a moment to be in silent prayer for these things or anything else that you have on your heart and mind this morning. Dear Lord, we thank you that you are a God of compassion and a God of justice. Lord, we thank you that you are willing to forgive us when we fail, when we make mistakes. And we also thank you and praise you that you call us to something more, call us to live in a certain way that gives life, and that you're willing to fight for us. Lord, I pray right now that as individuals and as a church, we would examine our lives to see if there are things that might lead us to be sick, or if we already are sick. And Lord, that you would clean those away, that you would refine us by fire. Lord, that we would be obedient to you, and that we would be a church that stands on your truth. Lord, this day I continue to lift up the global conflicts that we have. We pray for peace and diplomacy to prevail in Ukraine and Russia. And we pray for the fallout of this conflict in places of the world where people are already struggling. Lord, we pray for the families and the community in Buffalo as they were part of or witnessed a horrific event. And so, Lord, we just pray for healing in the midst of all of those lives. And Lord, I pray that that community and that those families will grow together and grow stronger because of this event, Lord, that your love would just radiate and shine in that darkness. Lord, we pray for Mary and Gordy. We pray for peace and for comfort for both of them. And Lord, we ask that the church just come around both of them to lift them up in our prayers, but also to support them in other ways. Lord, we pray for this little baby that is about to be born and for the surgery that it needs. And so, Lord, we just pray for a healthy and successful delivery, and we pray for a successful surgery and recovery as well. And Lord, we pray that that family may be blessed because of this new child. Lord, we pray for Jean, who continues to recover from heart surgery. Lord, we just ask that strength and comfort would be there, and that the support that they need would be available. And Lord, as always, we lift up our sister May, who is just a special part of this community. And Lord, we just ask that you would just place your healing hands on her and guide her, give her your comfort and peace and strength, and help her to know how much she is deeply loved. Lord, we also lift up to you this day the things that have been unspoken, those things in the deep places of our heart. Lord, you know those. You're already at work. And we pray that your will be done in each and every one of those things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, will you join me in our Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let us join together in our closing song, He is the Way, and we'll sing verses 1, 3, and 5. I invite you to stand if you can comfortably do so this morning. Send His Son to be our Savior. Friends, hear this benediction. Do not be ashamed to testify to the truth. Join the afflicted in lament and grief. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you, a seed of faith and a spirit of courage. Go forth in peace. Amen.